Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wahlberger, and today I want to tell you about a new course called Exceptional Structures in Mathematics and Physics from Dynamics on Graphs. My intention is that this is going to be a very broad-ranging and fascinating course touching base with all kinds of interesting things, but it's going to be the same kind of hands-on, somewhat informal, active course as my solving polynomial equations course. So this is part of this umbrella of explore research level maths, where I'm aspiring to put together opportunities for lay people, undergraduates, people who are interested in mathematics to not just admire mathematics from a distance, but actually to tackle it directly head on by choosing a very nice path that shows you interesting things, but also gives you opportunities for exploration and for learning. Okay, so this course is, like the Solving Polynomial Equations course, is going to be at Wild Egg Math, a sister channel of my Insights into Mathematics channel, and it will be for members. Okay, so I do hope that you will think about becoming a member and partaking in this. So in today's video, I want to give you an overview of the general area in which this course is going to be taking place. And it may cover quite a lot of territory. In the course, hopefully a lot of these things will become more clear. So some of the concepts that I'm going to be talking about today are rather sophisticated ones, and I'm not expecting you to understand them or to have a lot of familiarity with them. But nevertheless, I want you to appreciate which kind of areas this course is going to be moving in, and thereby, you know, which kinds of things you can find out about by taking the course. Okay, so let's have a look at things. Okay, so a starting point is a very interesting family of graphs. Okay, a graph just like bunch of nodes connected with edges. And these graphs are called the ADE graphs, and they are appearing down this first column here. There's two families, ongoing families of these graphs, the AN and the DN families. AN graphs are just a chain of N vertices connected sequentially by edges. The DN are almost the same, except that at one end, there's a kind of a fork. Okay, but otherwise they're like a chain. And then there are these three exceptional ones, the E6, the E7, and the E8 graphs. Now, these are amongst the most remarkable of all mathematical objects. That's become clear in the 20th century, and there's still a lot of mystery as to why these particular graphs are so important. And there's lots of answers, okay? So they come up in many, many areas. And this is going to be a sort of a primary, sort of first point of discussion, is to try to address the issue of where do these graphs come from, why are they important, and what role do they play? Why do they play the roles they do? I might mention that they have a kind of variant. So there's these sort of associated graphs, which are almost like these ones, but just with an extra node attached, or ADE tilde graphs. And then all the other graphs are sort of in some other compartment. And one way to separate graphs into these three families is to talk about a certain invariant, a sort of a spectral invariant that has to do with eigenvalues of adjacency matrices. And so that invariant being less than 2 gives you these ones, being exactly equal to gives you these ones, and all other graphs you get something that's bigger than 2. So, you know, from a graph theoretical point of view, there's a quite natural way of separating these things. But actually, graph theorists themselves generally don't pay all that much attention to these things, I think it's maybe fair to say. Now, so I'm talking about exceptional structures. And there are lots of exceptional structures in mathematics, okay, of course. And what do we mean by an exceptional structure? Well, we mean something which is maybe not in some family of things. So it's not just one of many things, you know, that there's these objects that sort of occupy a singular or unusual or exceptional position in the mathematical world. And probably the best example of these things are the Platonic solids, going back to the ancient Greeks. Okay, there are five Platonic solids. These are solids with a great amount of symmetry, and they are, of course, the tetrahedron, the octahedron, the cube, and the dodecahedron and the icosahedron. Of course, these have been studied from antiquity, and Euclid's Elements was very interested in these things. And I just want to suggest that there is, in fact, some kind of connection between the Platonic solids and these ADE type graphs. So, for example, if you concoct or look at these three numbers, P, let's say there are P faces around an edge, there are Q edges around a vertex, and R vertices around a face, or there's also a dual formulation, then you can encode these things with certain triples of numbers, like the icosahedron or the dodecahedron encoded with numbers 2, 3, 5, and you can associate to those numbers some kind of graphs, a trivalent kind of tree. And these end up being a lot like the ADE graphs, some condition on the P, Qs, and Rs. Okay, the ADE graphs themselves first arose in mathematics with the classification of simple Lie algebras. Okay, so these are interesting algebraic objects that come up in geometry, but also in differential equations, lots of things, in considerations of symmetries very generally. And Wilhelm Killing in 1888 classified the simple Lie algebras, and he found that there were four sort of families, A and B and C and D, and so these were sort of ongoing or infinite families, we usually say. And they're associated with the classical groups, like the symplectic group, the orthogonal groups, and just the projective or general linear group. And then, in addition to these four infinite or ongoing families, there were these five exceptional things called E6, E7, E8, and F4 and G2. And these Lie algebras were certainly exceptional things. And, you know, their dimensions are given by these numbers, 78, 133. E8 is dimension 248. That's going to play a very interesting role in this course. And then there's F4, 52, and G2, 14. And then later in the 20th century, Dynkin was studying geometrical objects or configurations called root systems and was able to classify them. They're also connected with simple Lie algebras, and he came up with these sort of diagrams that encode the information of these root systems, and thereby the simple Lie algebras. Here's a picture of Dynkin, there's a picture of Killing. Okay, and then there's this other, the groups theory side of the story. Associated to Lie algebras, there are things called Lie groups, which are symmetry groups, which have a kind of continuous or differential aspect, associated symmetric spaces, higher dimensional analogs of spheres in some sense. And it turns out that associated to these things, there are these more discrete reflection groups. And this is a story that involves famous German mathematician Hermann Weyl, who realized that you could, say, start with a simple Lie algebra, consider associated Lie group, and then associated to this a certain kind of finite group called these days a Weyl group, which is a generalization of the symmetric group that plays a crucial role sort of in the structure theory of these simple Lie algebras. And then later, Coxeter, one of the great geometers of the 20th century, was studying reflection groups just in Euclidean geometry, and he was classifying these things, and he found also a strong connection with these Weyl groups, and he came up with graphs that very very much like the Dynkin diagrams, these Coxeter graphs. You can see E6 here, E78, and there's a few other ones as well. So it's a very rich story, and you know, this is about less than 10% of all the occurrences of the ADE graph. So I could go on for a long time listing, remarkable places where these ADE graphs come up. But I want to point out that they are also involved in mathematics, which is close to physics, and indeed in physics itself. So there's von Neumann algebras and 2-1 factors. In physics, there's conformal field theory, and these days, West-Zumino-Witten models, fusion rule algebras. This is basically some kind of string theory. So these ADE graphs figure prominently. They occur in catastrophe theory. They occur as simple singularities or classifying simple singularities of holomorphic functions. And there's many other occurrences of them in combinatorics and algebra. So somehow these ADE graphs are a common aspect to many, many different things. And many people have asked the question, why is this? Can we explain this? Why should these graphs play such almost a unifying role between what sometimes might be called, disparate topics? So I have my own take on that. It's not a complete answer, but I have a point of view on why that is, which I think I can explain to you in ultimately a very elementary way. That it turns out, so from my point of view, currently we have all these sort of relatively fancy theories, and then you delve into them and you get these ADE graphs. Somehow at the heart of things are these ADE graphs. So my point of view is, okay, all right, if this is the way the world is, then we should be able to start with the ADE graphs. The ADE graphs themselves should be intrinsically interesting. And we might look to try to create mathematics from the ADE graphs, like a theory, essentially a graph theoretical theory, that gets bigger and bigger and starts revealing some of these other topics as emergent from the graph theory. So I want to put the graph theory sort of as a primary object here. I want to see how the graph theory connects and explains these other things. Okay, so I have a way of doing this. It's called the mutation game. And it's a kind of a dynamical game on graph. And it turns out to be dual to a game that had previously been introduced by Moses called the Numbers Game. But I'm going to tell you only about the Mutation Game. During the course, you'll learn also about the Numbers Game. So this is just a very brief introduction, just so you get a sense of what's going to happen. So let's start with X, which is a simple connected graph. Simple means there's only, at most one edge between any two vertices. The edges are not directed. There's no loops. Okay. We'll say that a population on X is an integer-valued function on the vertices. So we just assign integers to the vertices. And let's let P of X be the populations on X. Okay, so here is a graph with four vertices, X, Y, Z, and W. And here is a population on that graph. Has minus 1 at X, 2 at Y, 4 at W, and 3 at Z. So we could encode that with some kind of vector, say if we ordered the vertices, minus 1, 2, 4, 3. Okay, now I need to introduce what a mutation is. So a mutation at a vertex, denoted by S sub Y. You can say Y is a vertex, so we're going to mutate at Y. What does this do? So it takes the population and it changes it. But it changes it in a pretty minimal way. It only changes the value at y. So all the other values are unchanged. So S sub y only changes the value at y. And what does it do? Well, it takes the current value at y, which is 2, okay? And it does sort of two things in order. First of all, it negates that value. So the 2 turns into minus 2. And then what it does is it adds the sum of the values at all the direct neighbors of y to that. All right. So here the neighbors of y are x, w, and z. The sum of the values of the neighbors is 4 plus 3 plus minus 1. That's 6. So we have to add 6 to the minus 2. So mutation at y changes the 2 to a minus 2, and then adds 6 to give us 4. Okay, so that's the effect of the mutation S sub y on this population to give us this new population. So here's the new population, minus 1, 4, 4, 3. Just to practice, let's just convince ourselves of an important property of these things, that if we do this again, say to this thing here, that we're going to get back to where we started. So let's do that. So suppose we mutate again at y. So the 4 turns into minus 4. Then we have to add the sum of the neighbors. But the sum of the neighbors is the same as it was before because they haven't changed. That's still going to be 6. So we're going to get minus 4 plus 6. Yes, indeed, we get back to 2. It's not hard to convince yourself that's always going to happen. All right, so that's mutation. That's a mutation at a vertex, which affects population. And that's the starting point of this mutation game, which I think is like the most interesting game that you can play on a graph. And in the course, I'm going to give you a lot of evidence for that, because we're going to see that this is such a rich thing. Okay. So let's illustrate that, okay, with one of the exceptional ADE graphs, E6, okay, the smallest of the E series, the one that's easiest to deal with. So here's E6. It's got these vertices. You might label them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 0 up there. And here is a picture of a population. Actually, it's a population that's mostly 0. It just has a single 1 in one of the vertices. We'll call that a singleton population, all right? Okay. So if you start with that population and you apply, say, S2. So S2 is referring to that vertex there, right? So you apply the mutation at that. What happens? Well, the 0 turns into minus 0, which is still 0. And then you have to add 1. So you're going to get a 1 there. So this 1 here expands to give us 1, 1. Okay, so let's, say, arbitrarily decide to do S3. Okay, if we do S3 to this, well, then you're going to get a 1 there. And here's a particular sequence of mutations. Okay, why they're chosen this way is a question. But it's a sequence that increases the population. At each step, we're increasing the population. Here's S4, and then S5 gets us over here, S0 to here, S3 to here. You see, at S3 here, if we take the mutation here, we're going to get a minus 1 plus 3, that's 2. So we're getting a 2 there. And then another S2 gives us this one, and S4 gives us this one, and S3 gives us this one, and another S0 gives us this one. And at this stage, we get the population 1, 2, 3, 2, 1, 2. And it turns out this is the maximum population. You can't get any more than this. So this, even if you try all kinds of other different sequences of mutations, you cannot get a population that's bigger than this one. This is a rather remarkable property of this particular graph. Okay. And in fact, this particular maximal population ends up playing a big role in Lie theory, actually, and in representation theory and various things. So it's actually a very interesting mathematical object, and we can see it arising in this pretty simple fashion. Okay, so now let's introduce the idea of a root population, or just formally the roots. So a root population is a population obtained from a singleton population, that is, everywhere is zeros except for a single one in one place, by applying any sequence of mutations. So X is an arbitrary, simple, connected graph, and R of X then denotes the root populations of the graph X, those populations that you can get by starting with a singleton and performing any kind of mutations. So, for example, here is a pretty simple little graph. This is called D4. It's in the D family. It's got 4 vertices, sort of the central one here. And here are the 4 singleton populations where we, you know, denote an integer value function sort of in the obvious way, just in terms of the positions of the values, okay? So, here are the 4 initial possible singleton populations, and here are the various populations that you can get by applying suitable mutations. And you can see that, you know, you can get at one of these things in multiple ways. So you could get at this one here by starting with this one and performing one of these mutations and then one of these, or you could get it by going in this direction first and then this direction. So there's a kind of an interesting interleaving of the possibilities of these mutations. So it also turns out that in this case, the set of all roots is actually quite simple. It consists of these things together with their negatives. In other words, if we replace one of these things with a minus one, then that's also obtainable, because if you start with a singleton like this and you mutate at the vertex where there is a one, then that one is going to change into a minus one. And so then everything that you can get at from this one by mutations, you can get a corresponding negative version by going to that negative singleton and doing the same sequence. So the roots have a kind of a symmetry, or maybe symmetry. So on one side there's the positive roots, and on the other side there's the negative roots, and they're completely symmetrical. So it really suffices to just display the positive roots, okay, the roots whose values are all positive, and by positive I always mean greater than or equal to zero. Great. Okay, so now an important theorem, okay, that explains from this point of view why the ADE graphs are interesting and important. That R of X is finite. Well, so the set of roots is finite precisely when X is an ADE graph. In other words, it's in this following list. It's either an AN graph, a DN graph, or E6, E7, or E8. Okay. And furthermore, these collections R of X turn out to be exactly the irreducible, so-called simply laced root systems that were studied by Dynkin. Okay, that roughly means these are sets of vectors in a Euclidean space, and they have satisfying symmetry properties with respect to reflections in hyperplanes that are determined by the vectors. Okay, so they have sort of strong geometrical connections, and we're seeing then the ADE graphs appearing from this mutation point of view, and we're also seeing these classical root systems, which are these essentially geometrical objects, appearing from this point of view. Okay, and now we come to an important conjecture, which from my point of view is the most interesting conjecture in graph theory. Okay, this I would really love to see a resolution to this. The conjecture is that for any simple connected graph X, R of X is always the disjoint union of positive and negative roots. In other words, it's impossible to get a root which has both strictly positive values, that is greater than zero, and strictly negative values. It doesn't matter which graph you choose, not just an ADE. For any graph whatsoever, R of X is always consisting of roots which are either always positive, or all negative. Now, I do happen to know, I'm pretty sure that this is correct, because Bob Howlett once explained to me that it's very possibly or likely to be a consequence of the theory of Coxeter groups. So there's a chapter of group theory that sort of deals with the kinds of reflection groups that occur here. But what I would like is to understand this from a combinatorial or a graph theoretical point of view. Okay, so it's essentially a positivity condition, and so there should be a reason for this positivity. Okay, so I think this is really important conjecture, and I think solving it will shed probably light on lots of things. We're not, I think this is too hard for us to aspire to do, but we might have a go. Okay. I want to give you a little bit of an idea of the richness of the story. So here is that E6 graph that we looked at before. There it is right there, okay? And here are the singleton populations, written in the obvious way. So this thing here represents the function, which is zero everywhere except the vertex one, where it's one. Okay, and here are the singletons. And here are the various positive roots that you can create up to this maximal one that we've already seen. So we sort of took a wander through here, but in fact, the entire story has this interesting, rich combinatorial structure. And, you know, combinatorialists love this kind of thing. It's a poset, and then we can ask all kinds of interesting questions about the poset structure here. You know, is it a lattice, or what kind of poset is it? And it's a very, very interesting object. And it turns out that then the number of positive roots is, here there's 36 if you count them, and then if you include the corresponding negative ones, which look exactly the same, then you get a total of 72. Which is almost the dimension of the corresponding simple Lie algebra, except you have to add 6 for a certain reason. Okay. Okay, I'm not going to say too much about this. Let me just say that if you analyze things, you know, in the very simple case of just having a very simple graph with only two vertices, it's already still quite interesting. And then you only have two mutations, S1 and S2. And it turns out they satisfy sort of some interesting properties. So they're both involutions. So if you perform them twice, you get back to the identity. But crucially, they satisfy this braid relation. Okay, braid relation. That if you do S1 and then you do S2 and then you do S1, that's the same as what you get if you start with S2 and then do S1 and then do S2. Okay, and there's, okay, some interesting sort of configuration, a little hexagon there that appears when you analyze the algebra of these things. Okay, and then there are, you know, in three dimensions, there's some more elaborate structure. We might talk more about this. You know, it would take some explaining to explain this. There's some interesting stuff. So we'll touch base with something called the permutahedron. You can see it's a nice, not a platonic solid exactly, but it's a nice Archimedean solid, I suppose. And it has interesting connections with the algebra. Now, there's another aspect here that's really important, okay? In that there's geometry floating around here. And because I'm very geometrically oriented, this is really interesting to me. And so what happens is that if you start with, again, an arbitrary graph here, not necessarily ADE, okay, then you can associate a symmetric bilinear form on the populations via a certain symmetric matrix. You take 2 times the identity matrix minus the adjacency matrix of the graph, okay? So, and what you get then is a symmetric matrix which encodes some geometry, okay? And in this simple example, for example, A, B, C, D, the geometry is encoded by this quadratic form, okay? So it's called the Titz quadratic form, and here's 2a squared plus 2b squared plus 2c squared plus 2d squared minus ab minus bc minus b. So this is a quadratic form. And then the theorem is that the mutations that we've been talking about, these mutations at vertices, are isometries with respect to this quadratic form. Okay, that means that we don't just have algebraic maneuverings going on. We have geometry floating around. Okay, so this is a very beautiful thing. So this, the group generated by all these reflections, okay, is a group of isometries. Okay, so then one can start to look at this, and I have a rather non-standard point of view on this, which I will explain at some point. You know, so if you start with this very simple graph, this A2 graph, then here is the corresponding root system, the way I think one should think about this. This is quite different from what you find in textbooks. You know, in texts and in papers in this subject, you find a kind of a hexagonal picture of these roots, but I think it's better to look at it this way, so it avoids irrationality. So we can do this all over the rationals, which is a very attractive aspect. We don't need a square root of 3, for example, in order to encode what's really going on here. Okay, so that means we're touching base with rational trigonometry, with my book, so quadrants and spread, which are the natural ingredients for rational trigonometry, are naturally going to be associated with the story. Right? So that means that graph theory itself is going to create a very rich arena where we can apply a lot of rational trigonometry ideas directly to analyzing these dynamics that are appearing. Okay, so the root systems that we've been talking about are generated by these mutations. But classically, a root system is just a set of vectors in Euclidean space, which has a kind of invariance property with respect to associated perpendicular reflections. So you have a vector, then there's a sort of a perpendicular hyperplane, then you consider the reflection in that hyperplane, and then if the entire set of roots is mapped to itself in a particularly kind of nice integral way, then you have a root system. So in the case when the root systems are finite, namely the A to E system, then we get the classical root systems. But it turns out that if X is an arbitrary graph, you still get what we might call a generalized, simply laced root system. So that the geometry is still there, it's just that these root systems are no longer finite, so they're unbounded. Okay, which is more complicated, but the essential beautiful root system properties are still there. And this is for an arbitrary graph. Okay, that means it's just an incredible amount of investigation that can be made into the geometry of these root systems for general graphs X, not just the ADEs. Okay, so then there's a very rich story of root hyperplanes, Weyl chambers, orbits connecting with the standard model of particle physics, the eightfold way, and very important for physicists. And we can think about this in a somewhat new and rather direct way without, you know, having to start with Lie groups. Okay, I would like to also just point out that this general point of view, where we're looking at the dynamics of these populations on these very discrete things, this is connecting also, I think, with an interesting program in modern physics. So there is a question about whether space-time is discrete or not. Okay, and if so, what kinds of dynamics are being played out? So people have been thinking about this, you know, for a long time. In some way, I mean, the general idea, you know, the majority opinion is that, you know, things are continuous, but you know, it's clear now that as you scale down, you get to the Planck scale, and we don't know anymore what the real nature of this thing is. So we can make certain assumptions, but really they're just assumptions. And the assumption that things are continuous, that you know, things, which is almost the same as things are infinitely divisible in some way, right? That's perhaps not so likely as it used to be. So there's at least a possibility, and one of the people who are I think really pushing this point of view in an interesting way is Stephen Wolfram and his group. So he has a project that tries to model aspects of modern physics, like notably quantum mechanics and general relativity, on discrete space times which are created from cellular automata which are allowed to run. And these cellular automata should have a strong sort of causal invariance property for things to be nice. But anyway, so it's quite an intriguing possibility. And without, you know, passing a judgment on whether it's correct physics or not, I think that at least there's a possibility that this mutation and dual numbers games that I want to be telling you about, that they also generate very rich combinatorial structures, which are at some level kind of akin to some of the things that Wolfram is looking at. But they're a little bit more structured than his. And so it might be that this provides some kind of alternative arena for doing some kind of discrete physics, maybe. So to give you just a taste of something, you know, because I think it's nice to delve into these things yourself. I've told you what a mutation is. I've explained to you what a set of roots is. So here's an exploration. You know, you choose a general graph X, probably not a very complicated one, like maybe this one here. Okay, there's a graph X. Can you describe the set of roots? Okay, that's such an interesting question. So we'll be seeing a lot more interesting challenges like this as we delve into the course, as we explore the things I've been telling you about, but lots of other things too. So I'm hoping this will be rather extensive. It'll probably go on for quite a long time. There's a lot of things to explain and to investigate. And I hope that, you know, you'll benefit from the hands-on kind of direct and sort of informal, chatty approach that I'm going to take, where I'm really going to, you know, take you along with me on I think, a journey of investigation and discovery. So I hope you will be joining us. Okay, you do that by becoming a member of the Wild Egg Mass channel, okay, which will give you access to all kinds of other interesting things too. So I do hope that you will be joining us.